Welcome everyone. In this session, we will be studying about the embryology and the basic anatomy of the ear. Now, first of all, we will study about the external ear, that is the pinna and the external auditory canal and also the tympanic membrane. So, first of all, pinna. So, these are the basic features of a pinna. We can see the outermost rim, this is the helix. Inside it, it is the antihelix. We have a cartilaginous part medially, which is known as tragus. Just opposite to it, it is antitragus. Between tragus and antitragus, we have intertrachic notch. Now, this is the lobule of the pinna. The importance of this lobule is that it does not have any cartilage. It is made up of only fat. Now, this cartilage, which is adjacent to the external auditory meatus, this is known as the conchal cartilage. Now, this cartilage is important because it can be used as a graft materials for various otoplasty and tympanoplasty procedures. Now, embryologically, if we see, the pinna develops from the first and the second brachial arches at 4 to 6 weeks of gestations. And the adult size of pinna, it is configured at 20th week. Now, the parts of the pinna, they develop from the first, some parts develop from the first arch and others from the second arch. So we'll look into it. The tragus and this is crus of helix. So these two parts, they develop from the first arch. And the rest of the pinna, that is helix, antihelix, lobule, all these they develop from the second brachial arch. Now there are six hillocks of His embryologically, which fuse to form this pinna as we see it. Now since it is an embryological structure, so during development, there might be some anomalies in that. So the most common we see, it is a preauricular sinus. Now preauricular sinus is a development anomaly of the pinna in which the first and the second hillocks, they fail to fuse. So the patient will be having a sinus at around this part, just anterior to the tragus. The sinus can be discharging or it can be inactive. The treatment of this preauricular sinus is surgical excision. Another developmental anomaly is the caul oral fistula. Now it is the failure of the fusion of the ventral part of first brachial cleft. So it has two openings. The upper part of the caul oral fistula, it opens in the floor of the external auditory canal. While the other part, that is the lower part, it opens in just below the angle of the mandible. So it is caul. Caul means collar. Oral means ear. So caul oral fistula. Other anomaly is bat ear, also known as lop ear. So in this anomaly, this antihelix, this is poorly formed. So there is excess of conchal cartilage. So this is known as bat ear. Other one is melosia, that is low set ears. Now if a line is drawn from the lateral canthus of the eye, it should bisect the pinna at this place, that is some part of the pinna should be above this line. If no part of the pinna is above this line and this line crosses and the whole of the pinna is below, that is known as melosia or the low set ears. Other anomaly is Potter's syndrome. Now in this anomaly, the pinna, they are flat and large and they are associated with abnormal limb positioning also, pulmonary hypoplasia and compression facies. So it is a syndrome. Another syndrome is Wildermuth's ear. Now in this, it is just opposite to that of bat ear. In this ear, the helix is underdeveloped and the antihelix, this is prominent. So this is just opposite what we saw in bat ear. Other thing is Mozart's ear. In this anomaly, the helix and the antihelix, they both are fused together. Now comes otoplasty. Otoplasty is like any plasty, it is the reconstruction of the pinna. Now it is done for anosia and microtia. Now anosia is complete absence of the pinna and microtia is only rudimentary parts are present, the rest of the pinna is underdeveloped. Now the important thing to note in this point is that it should be done at 6 years of age using a rib cartilage, because at that time the ribs are fully developed, not before 6 years of age. Another way of doing otoplasty is that preformed ears are available in the market and they can be fixed. but they have a greater rejection rate. So otoplasty using a rib cartilage is a better technique. Another congenital anomaly is hemiphageal microsomia. Hemiphageal means not only the pinna but whole of the half of the face it is underdeveloped. So it is hemiphageal microsomia. Other one is golden hair syndrome. In this also there is unilateral microtia and small malformed mandible. Golden hair syndrome. Another anomaly, it is oculo-auriculo-vertebral dysplasia. Now as the name suggests, there is some anomaly of the eyes, some anomaly of the ears and some anomaly of the vertebra. So in eyes, there are epibulbar dermoids. As we can see in this slide, there are epibulbar dermoids seen in the eyes. In ears, there is unilateral microtia, also small malformed mandible, associated with anomalies of the cervical spine to complete the syndrome. Now another term is synoechia. Now in synoechia, the ears they are very close to each other due to the absence or hypoplasia of mandible. Either the mandible is absent or it is hypoplastic, so the distance between the two ears is decreased. That is known as synoechia. Now we move on to another part of the external ear, that is the external auditory canal. Now external auditory canal, it develops from the dorsal end of the first branchial cleft. Now during the development of the head and neck structures, we have clefts, we have arches and we have pouches. So there are different structures we develop either from arch, from pouch or from clefts. That is a table which we will see later. But for now, the external auditory canal, it develops from the dorsal end of the first branchial cleft. And it develops by the 41st day of the fetal life. It is S-shaped. It is not a straight canal. It is a rather curved canal. So to make it straight, you have to push the pinna upward, backward and laterally in order to see the tympanic membrane. The length of the external auditory canal, it is 24 millimeters, out of which the outer 8 millimeters, that is one third, it is cartilaginous in structure. And the inner 16 millimeters, that is two third, it is bony. Now, there are some named fissures which are present in the external auditory canal. One of them is fissures of Santorini. Now these are two vertical fissures which are present in the cartilaginous part of the pinna. The clinical importance of these fissures is that infection of the mastoid and the parotid, they pass through them. Also, the cartilaginous part, because it contains hair follicles, it is a site for formation of the furuncles. And also because it has ceruminous and pilosebaceous glands, so wax formation occurs here. Other one is the foramen of Haschke, also known as foramen tympanicum. Now they are present in the anterior-inferior part of the bony external auditory canal, unlike Santorini, which are present in the cartilaginous part. Tympanic membrane, coming on to the tympanic membrane. So now we look at the tympanic membrane. The dimensions of the tympanic membrane are, it is 10 mm tall length, 9 mm wide, and the thickness of this membrane is 0.1 mm. These are the average values. Now it is not at 90 degree to the floor of the external auditory canal, rather it is positioned at around 55 degrees to the floor of the canal. It has three layers. First one is the innermost layer, that is endoderm, which develops from the first branchial pouch. Now the important thing is that this is pouch, this is not a cleft or this is not an arch, this is pouch. Endoderm develops from the first branchial pouch. Middle layer, it is the middle fibrous layer known as mesoderm, and ectoderm, it is the outermost layer which develops from the first branchial cleft. So cleft and pouch. Pouch is endoderm, cleft is ectoderm. Okay, now if we look at this diagram, we can see that the upper part of the tympanic membrane. This is known as pars flaccida, also known as Scharpnell's membrane. Pars flaccida because it is not tense, it is flaccid. Lower part of the tympanic membrane, this is pars tensa. Tensa means it is stretched. And in the anterior-inferior quadrant of the tympanic membrane, we are able to see this cone of light when we look to the tympanic membrane via an otoscope or any light. We can see a cone of light in the anterior-inferior quadrant of the tympanic membrane. So this question can be asked whether cone of light is visible in which quadrant. So it is visible in the anterior-inferior quadrants. We can divide the tympanic membrane into four quadrants: anterior, anterior-superior, anterior-inferior, posterior-superior, and posterior-inferior. So this is anterior-inferior quadrant. Now this is the handle of malleus, which we are able to visualize via an otoscope. The lowermost point of the handle of malleus from which the cone of light originates, it is known as ambu. And these two folds, these are the anterior and the posterior malleal folds. They are arising from the handle of the malleus. So they are anterior and posterior malleal folds. Above this is pars flaccida, that is Scharpnell's membrane. Now, this is the bony annulus, the outermost margin of the tympanic membrane. This is fibrous annulus, which is fixed in the bony socket. At the superior most part, the bony socket is absent, which is known as notch of Rivenus. Now, we are also able to see some part of the incus via a normal tympanic membrane. So, as I explained earlier, we can see in the slide, the pars flaccida, it is the superior portion of the tympanic membrane located in the notch of Rivenus. It is known as flaccida because it is less stiff, sparse, disorganized fibrous layer. Pars tensa, it is the Scharpnell's membrane. So it is the vibrating surface of the tympanic membrane. And the outermost fibrous ring of the tympanic membrane, that is known as the annulus fibrosus. Now, we'll see the nerve supply of the pinna, the external auditory canal, and the tympanic membrane, that is whole of the external ear. So this is the lateral surface of pinna. The main nerve supply of the lateral surface of pinna, it is by the greater auricular nerve with a root value of C2 and C3. The portion anteriorly and superiorly, it is supplied by the auriculotemporal nerve. It is a branch of the mandibular nerve with a root value of V3. That is the fifth nerve, that is trigeminal nerve, third branch. And some of the portion which is around the external auditory meatus, it is supplied by the seventh cranial nerve and also the tenth cranial nerve. Now the branch of the tenth cranial nerve which supplies this part, it is known as Arnold's nerve or the auricular branch of the vagus nerve. We look at the medial surface of the pinna. Again, this is the greater auricular nerve. Some part of the superior portion of the medial surface, it is supplied by the lesser occipital nerve, that is C2. And again, this part is supplied by the 7th nerve and the 10th cranial nerve. Now, importance of this cranial nerve innervation here is that it is a cause of the sign known as Hisselberg's sign, which we will see in our next sessions. It is seen in acoustic neuroma, where there is numbness in this area because of the involvement of this branch of the 7th nerve. Now the nerve supply of the tympanic membrane. So tympanic membrane, it has different nerve supplies in its lateral part and the medial part. The whole of the medial part of the tympanic membrane, it is supplied by the tympanic branch of the 9th cranial nerve, that is glossopharyngeal nerve. This branch is known as Jacobson's nerves. So Arnold's nerve, it's a branch of a 10th cranial nerve. Jacobson's branch, it's a branch of a 9th cranial nerve. And the lateral surface of the pinna, as far as nerve supply is concerned, it can be divided into two parts. The anterior part of the lateral surface of the pinna, it is supplied by auriculotemporal nerve. And the posterior part, it is supplied by the vagus nerve. Now we move on to the tympanic cavity proper. So the tympanic cavity can be divided into various parts. First one is the epitympanum. Now, epitympanum is that part of the tympanic cavity which is above the pars tensa. So, if you can imagine, this is a two-dimensional structure. So, tympanic membrane will be like this, if you look it from this side. And the part which is above the tympanic pars tensa, including pars flaccida part, which is above the pars tensa. So, this part approximately, this is known as epitympanum, and it is the widest part of the tympanic cavity around 6 mm in breadth. Other part which is just opposite to the pars tensa, that is known as mesotympanum. So this part, this is the mesotympanum. This is the narrowest part with a breadth of around 2 mm. And the part which is below the pars tensa, that is hypotympanum, which is around 4 mm in breadth. Now the anterior, posterior and the vertical diameters of the tympanic cavity, they are approximately 15 mm. One more part, the part of the tympanic cavity which is surrounding the eustachian tube area, that is known as protympanum. Now what is middle ear cleft? This is middle ear only. The cleft includes everything. So the middle ear cleft includes the middle ear, the adytus, the antrum, the mastoid ear cells and the eustachian tube. The mucosal lining of this middle ear cleft, it varies from site to site. If we look at the anterior and the inferior walls, they are lined by the ciliated columnar epithelium with goblet cells. The floor, this is lined by the cuboidal cells with loss of cilia. And the attic and the antrum, they are lined by the pavement epithelium. Now, important point to note here is that squamous epithelium is not present anywhere in the middle ear cavity. Why I am saying this point now? Because when we look at cholestatoma, we'll be see that it is the skin at wrong place. Normally, there is no squamous epithelium present in the middle ear cavity. So, this is the middle ear. Now, this middle ear can be compared to a matchbox with six sides. The roof, the floor, the anterior wall, the posterior wall, if you look at three-dimensionally, the lateral wall and the medial wall. Every wall has some important structures. We start with the roof. The roof of the middle ear, it is a thin plate of bone which is known as tegmen tympani. This tegmen tympani separates the middle ear from the middle cranial fossa. The floor. The floor is also a bone which separates the middle ear from the jugular pulp. Many a times, this bone is absent or dehiscent. So, the jugular bulb can be seen in the floor of the middle ear via an otoscope. The anterior wall of the middle ear, it has two openings. The upper one is an opening for tensor tympani tendon. And the lower one has an opening for eustachian tube. Now, the posterior wall of the middle ear. This wall has an important structure called as pyramid, where the stapes tendon is attached. From this pyramid, the tendon goes and the muscle attaches to the head of the stapes. This is floor, we saw it separates the middle ear from the jugular bulb. Now comes the lateral wall. So lateral wall, mostly it is formed by the tympanic membrane. The part which is above the tympanic membrane, that is known as the lateral outer attic wall, also known as scutum. Now comes the medial wall. There is a prominent bulge over the medial wall of the middle ear, which is known as promontory. Now that bulge is because of the underlying structure, that is the basal coil of cochlea. So this question can be asked, then the promontory, it is because of what? Other important structure in the medial wall of the middle ear is the processus cochleariformis. It is the bony spicule through which the tensor tympani tendon, it curves around and attaches to the neck of the malleus. Now ossicles. As we all know, there are three ossicles in the ear, in each ear, malleus, incus and stapes. So stapes is the short, smallest bone of the body. Now if we look at the development of the cartilaginous, again different parts of different cartilage, they develop from different arches. Now first branchial arch, which is also known as Meckel's cartilage. What are the structures which develop from this arch? That is the malleus head and neck. Then incus body and short process. And anterior malleolar ligament. We saw in the previous picture that anterior malleolar fold. So that develops from the Meckel's cartilage. The rest of the malleus, that is the manubrium, the rest of the incus, that is the long and the lenticular process, and the stapes, they all develop from the second branchial arch, which is also known as Richard's cartilage. But one point to note is that the medial part of the footplate of the stapes, it develops from the otic capsule, not from the second branchial arch. So it can be asked as a question. Now comes the temporal bone. So the temporal bone has five parts: the squamous part, petrous part, mastoid part, styloid process, and tympanic part. The squamous part, it forms the roof of the external auditory canal, the lateral wall of the antrum, and the lateral part of the mastoid. The petrous part, the whole of the middle and the inner ear. It is formed by the petrous part of the temporal bone. Then mastoid part. Now, importance of this mastoid part is that it develops after the first year of life. So if we have a x-ray mastoid of a neonate patient, we will not be able to see the mastoid part. Other parts are the styloid process and the tympanic part. These are the five parts of the temporal bone. Okay, as I told you earlier, that there are arches and clefts and pouches. So different arches, different derivatives. First we start with the branchial arches. Now first branchial arch, it is also known as mandibular arch. Now there are some arteries, some nerves, some muscles and some bones which develop from each branchial arch. This thing is more to remember, but still I'll go through it. The artery from the first branchial arch is the maxillary artery. The pre-traumatic nerve is mandibular nerve. Post-traumatic nerve is the cauda tympani, which is a branch of facial nerve. Some muscles which arise from the first branchial arch are the muscles of mastication, mylohyoid, anterior belly of digastric, tensor palati, and tensor tympani. You can correlate it that tensor tympani, it develops from the first arch, while we see later that the stapedius muscle, it develops from the second arch. So both are the muscles of the middle ear. And the bones which arise from the first arch, that is mandibular arch, are the malleus, incus, mandible, maxilla, zygomatic bone, temporal bone, and sphenomandibular ligament. The second arch, it is also known as hyoid arch. The artery which develops from this arch is the stapedial artery. The pre-traumatic nerve is facial nerve, while the post-traumatic is the Jacobson's nerve, that is the tympanic branch of the ninth cranial nerve. Muscles which arise from this arch are the muscles of the face, the posterior belly of digastric. Anterior one was from the first arch, posterior is from the second arch. The stylohyoid, stapedius, and auricular muscles, muscles of the pinna. The bones which arise from the second arch are the lesser horn and the upper portion of the body of hyoid. That is why it is known as hyoid arch. The stapes. The malleus and incus, they develop from the first arch, but the stapes, it develops from the second arch. The styloid process and the stylohyoid ligament. Now the third arch, the arteries which develop from this arch are the common carotid and internal carotid artery. The pre-traumatic nerve is the glossopharyngeal nerve. Now the third, fourth and fifth, these arches, they do not have a post-traumatic nerve. So this can again be asked as a question. The muscle which arises from the third branchial arch is the stylopharyngeus muscle and the bones, greater horn and lower portion of the body of the hyoid. The rest we saw it develops from the second arch. So the hyoid bone, it develops from the second and the third branchial arches together. The fourth arch, the arteries are the right subclavian artery and the left aortic arch. The pre-traumatic nerve is the superior laryngeal branch of vagus nerve. The muscles are cricothyroid and inferior constrictors of pharynx, while the bones are the thyroid cartilage, epiglottis and cuneiform. The fifth arch, the artery is the pulmonary artery. The pre-traumatic nerve is the recurrent laryngeal nerve. No post-traumatic nerve. The muscles are the intrinsic muscles of larynx, pharynx and soft palate. And the bones, they are the cricoid, arytenoid and the conicular cartilages. These are the laryngeal cartilages. So this completes the branchial arches. Now comes the pharyngeal pouches. So first pouch, each pouch has two parts, the ventral part and the dorsal part. Now if we look into this table, the first pharyngeal pouch, the ventral part, it gets obliterated, while the dorsal part, it gives rise to the middle ear cleft structures, that is the tubotympanic recess. Proximal part gives rise to eustachian tube and distal part middle ear cavity. The second pharyngeal pouch, the ventral part gives rise to the palatine tonsils and the dorsal gives adenoids. In third pouch, ventral part, it develops into thymus, the dorsal part into the inferior parathyroid gland. In fourth pouch, the ventral part develops small amount of thymus, mainly it is developed from the third pouch, and the dorsal part gives the superior parathyroid gland. And the fifth pouch, it gives rise to the ultimobranchial bodies, which give rise to the parafollicular C cells. So what is the applied anatomy of the external ear? First is pinna. Now it is a single yellow elastic cartilage except the lobule, which is made up of fat. Now simba conchae. It is a part of the pinna which overlies the Mass Evans triangle. Now it is a triangle of surgical importance which is bounded superiorly by the supramietal line, a part of the posterior superior part of the external auditory canal, and a tangent drawn from the external auditory canal which bisects the first line. The clinical importance of Mass Evans triangle is that the mastoid antrum during mastoid surgery, it lies around 1 to 1.5 cm below this triangle. Other thing is incisura terminalis. Now this is a part of the pinna which is between the anterior crus of helix and the tragus. This part is also devoid of cartilage. So during end oral approach in tympanoplasty, an incision can be put in this place without injuring any cartilage. Now the tragal cartilages, it can be used as a graft during myringoplasty surgeries and also sometimes in rhinoplasty surgeries. The perichondrium of the tragal cartilage, it also can be used as a graft in myringoplasty surgeries, and the fat from the lobule, it can be used as a graft material in fat myringoplasty. The conchal cartilage, it can be used in rhinoplasty surgery. For example, in augmentation rhinoplasty, where you have to augment the defect and the LR repair. Another clinical importance of the temporal bone is the presence of Corner's septum. Now, it is a persistent petrosquamosal suture. Normally, there is a membrane present between the petrous part and the squamous part of the temporal bone. But during development, it disappears. But many times, it is persistent, and the clinical importance it is that during mastoid surgery, when we locate the antrum and we come across this septum, so it is difficult to locate the antrum and the mastoid surgery can be incomplete without drilling or passing through this septum. Another part of the middle ear cleft is the eustachian tube. Now the length of the eustachian tube is 36 millimeters, out of which the lateral 12 millimeters, it is the bony part of the eustachian tube, while the inner 24 millimeter, it is the fibrocartilaginous part. Now the pharyngeal opening of the eustachian tube, it is behind and above the posterior end of the middle turbinate, 1 to 1.5 cm. So this inferior turbinate word is important because the examiners can confuse you by saying superior turbinate or middle turbinate, but the opening is behind and below the posterior end of the inferior turbinate. Now there are muscles which open the eustachian tube and muscles which close the eustachian tube. At rest, the eustachian tube is in a closed position. The muscles which open it are the tensor palati, which is the main opener of the eustachian tube, other being levator palati. And the muscles which close the eustachian tube, it is the salpingopharynxes. Now lymphatic drainage. So if we look at the lymphatic drainage of the whole of the external ear, so the tragus part, it drains into the preauricular nodes. The lobule part, it drains into the infraauricular nodes. The rest of the pinna, it drains into the postauricular nodes, and whole of the middle ear and the eustachian tube, they drain into the retropharyngeal lymph nodes. Now there is some important difference between the eustachian tube of a pediatric population and an adult population. The eustachian tube of children, it is generally shorter, wider, and more horizontally placed than that of an adult. The clinical importance being that infections from the pharynx and throat, they can easily transmit into the middle ear cavity and leads to recurrent middle ear infections. So with this, we conclude this session.